It is great to see you this morning. If you're worshiping with us online, just a reminder, with the COVID numbers going up here in San Antonio, we are encouraging folks to worship online. We're online only here. There's always a few folks that aren't on our email list, and we understand that. That's fine. Or we have visitors that stop in, and that's fine as well. But we are encouraging everyone to worship at home, online, if at all possible. And as soon as the COVID rate or warning level, whatever it is that Bexar County is using, drops back down to moderate, then we'll resume back where we have limited in-person worship. But we want to remind you that regardless of whether you're here in person or you are worshiping online, regardless of whether you live in the Windcrest area or you live overseas or where you're watching it live on Facebook or you watch it sometime later on in the week, you are fully included in our worship service. We want you to be part of our worshiping community, whether you're on campus or you're on our online campus. So there's several things that you can do. If you live in the area, you're welcome to come by the church office. We have the upper rooms out, but you can also get these online if you're not in the physical area. We also produce a monthly newsletter called The Connection. And so our first edition for 2021 is out. And so again, you can come by and pick one of those up. You can also let the church office know, and we'll be glad to mail you either or both of those two items. But both of them are available online. So please do check out our website. A lot of different activities going on. If you live in the area, you may have been involved in some of our activities such as Sit and Be Fit or Chair Yoga. Some of our, not only are they social activities, but they're physical health activities. We are going to suspend those for a little while. I don't have word about our feeding program, about our community cupboard. And so, and when I get word about that, we'll try to get that out as well. But that's typically on Thursday mornings, and so I haven't received word of what they plan on doing and how they plan on maintaining safe distancing and COVID. But we will keep you posted and keep you informed, so please do check. The office is going to be closed, technically, again, so, but if you have business in the church office, call and leave a message, and we will set up an appointment time, and we will have somebody down here to meet you. But one of the easiest ways to participate in our worship service is through text in church. The number's on the screen, 210-817-7007. If you're worshiping with us in person, please just take out your smartphone. If you left it in the car, you're smarter than I am, and that's wise. But just jot down that number on a piece of paper, 210-817-7007. And then if you'll text the simple word praise. And what you're doing is not only are you registering your attendance, but you're affirming your presence here as part of worship. You're saying, I don't just want to be a spectator. I want you to know I'm here. And I want to be involved, and I want to go to the next level. If you have prayer concerns, put them in the comment section if you're watching on Facebook, and that way people that watch throughout the rest of the week will be able to join you in praying. However, we recognize that there are some prayer concerns that you would like to share a little bit more privately, or maybe you'd like to have a private conversation with one of our pastors. You can do that online, and there are a variety of ways to do that. You can also do that in person, but you may want to go to our Facebook group. So you have to like our page, but once you like our page, you'll find an invitation to join several Facebook groups, but the one Windcrest United Methodist Church General Facebook group is a place that you can be in prayer conversation. So you can do that whether you live here in the Windcrest area or you live overseas. It may take a little while. I've been in a dialogue with a young man in our church, and it usually takes us about 6 to 12 hours to get a response. For a variety of reasons. So he'll post a prayer concern or a joy or celebration, and then 6 to 12 hours later, I'll be able to respond. And that's the benefit and blessing of being an online worshiping community. You can also give of your tithes and offerings. You can do that in person. Our gathering place is open from usually about 7 o'clock in the morning, but definitely by 8 or 9 every Sunday morning, and then we don't close it until noon. So you can walk in, there's offering plates at the doors. As you come in, there's also a black box on the table there if you want to put it into something more secure. But if giving of your tithes and offerings in person in a tangible way is an act of worship for you, we want you to be able to do that. But you'll notice on your screen there's also a text to give number where you can text an amount to that number, 210-960-8251, and it will walk you through the process of being able to make a contribution to the church of your tithes and offerings without ever having to be here on the physical campus. A couple of prayer concerns that I want to remind you of. Please be careful, folks. But also, remember those that can't get out, the most vulnerable. I believe that there are people that are really struggling. They moved into assisted living places so that they could be in a community, in a safe community. And with COVID, that got shut down. Or maybe they came to some of our activities here at the church, and that was the reason they got up and were active in that morning. And it gave them something to look forward to, being with other people. And when that's taken away, depression creeps in, the ability to just get out of bed. So if you're watching this in bed and you're thinking, oh, I just don't know, get up. Get out of bed. Brush your teeth. Have a cup of coffee or a cup of tea. Move around. If you're one of those people that's saying, I'm just so tired of this, I just wish this was over, and you're an able-bodied person, sit down and write a note to somebody that's not. Call them up. Send them an email. But a handwritten note, mail it to them so that they have a reason, something to look forward to. Set up a pen pal. Set up a call schedule where you call every morning at 10 o'clock. Something that gives other people an opportunity and a chance, something to look forward to. I want to ask you to pray for the following families. The Feltners have experienced a loss this past couple of weeks. The Greens have experienced a loss in the last couple of weeks. Britton Camps, the Sheltons. Just got an email this morning that another of our member families, Ronnie, tested positive. The Lindsays joined last week, and it's affiliated with the Lindsay family. We've had people that are starting to join the church virtually. You're invited to do so. You can let us know in that text message, 210-817-7007. Just put in there, I want to join the church. I want to change my relationship with the church. We will get in contact with you. We want you to know that you are part of this church. But one of the things that we want you to be part of is worship. And so we are indeed here to worship. We worship in song. We worship in praise. If you're here with us, obviously, hum. There's very few of us because we are limiting our availability, and we're encouraging people to stay home. But so if you're here with us, hum, sway, clap your hands. If you're at home, sing extra loud. What a beautiful name. Let us stand and sing.
What a beautiful name it is, of Jesus.
Amen. What a beautiful name it is. Gracious and glorious God, we give you thanks that you have given us the name as followers of Christ, as Christians, Christ-ones. So we pray for your church. We pray for your church universal as you have envisioned, as you have established. And we recognize that we're not there yet. We continue to work to be the faithful church, to love one another, to love our neighbors as ourselves, to serve and please you. So continue to guide your church as we carry the name of Christian. Be with all of those who minister today. Be with those that pray today. Be with those that worship today. May we be members of your heavenly kingdom. But we also pray for the worldly kingdoms. We give you thanks that you have given us, most of us, in the sound of my voice, who worship with us, take on the name of citizens of the United States of America. May we be united. May we be a beacon on a hill. May we be a shining example of what it means to cherish each and every person, to treat others with dignity and respect, to believe in the freedom of all people, to believe in justice and mercy. So be with our leaders, be with our politicians and statesmen and stateswomen, be with those who make policy decisions, that they may be faithful. As we move closer to January 6th, we are asked, who are we? What are our values? What are our priorities? What do we hold true and dear? So guide us and direct us. Shape us and mold us. We are not a perfect nation, but for those of us who live here, we choose to be here because we believe it's the best for us. But keep us mindful of other nations, other places, other people, people that do not have the same choices, the same freedoms, the same opportunities. We give you thanks for the opportunity to receive a vaccination to protect us from this pandemic. We give you thanks that we have schools, colleges, universities that allow for people to imagine, to dream, to help participate in your creation, to come up with this vaccination. And as we look for a protocol and how this vaccination will be distributed, keep us mindful of the countries that have discovered they'll just have to wait. That it may be as early as May before first responders can get it, because those with the money get them first. We give you thanks. Let us never take it for granted, but also let us never forget that we are part of your heavenly kingdom. And then we are a part of a nation, a state, a city, a community. So be with the leaders, be with those that govern on the city level, on the school level, on the county level, on the state level, on the national level, and nations all over the world, that they may have wisdom, that they may have peace, that they may have courage, that they may have compassion. We've lifted up those who just struggle to get out of bed. They're so tired. They're worried. Is it worth it anymore? Let them know that it is worth it, that they are loved, that they are cared for. And when their days here are over and their tasks are accomplished, help them to die as those who go forth to live. And remind each and every one of us that in our living and our dying, we are still members of the kingdom of heaven, that we are bound together, even if we are separated by distance, that we are your people. In your name, we claim and pray. We are broken vessels. Let us sing.
All these pieces broken and scattered, mercy gathered, mended and whole, empty-handed but not forsaken. I've been set free, I've been set free. Your treasure, in jars of clay. So take this heart, Lord, I'll be your vessel, the world to see your life in me.
Please join with me in our prayer of confession. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the way of peace. Come into the brokenness of our lives and our land with your healing love. Help us to be willing to bow before you in true repentance and to bow to one another in real forgiveness. By the fire of your Holy Spirit, melt our hard hearts and consume the pride and prejudice which separate us. Fill us, O Lord, with your perfect love, which casts out fear, and bind us together in that unity which you share with the Father and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now share with me these words of assurance as we say together, May Almighty God, who caused light to shine out of the darkness, shine in our hearts, cleansing us from all our sins and restoring us to the light of the knowledge of God's glory. In the face of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. So as we gather together virtually and in person, I hope you've had a wonderful Christmas season. It's part of the 12 days. We're still in the 12 days of Christmas. I'll talk about that a little bit later as part of my message. But I know that there were people that you normally would have Christmas with. The names that I mentioned, those families, they had a death in their family recently. And so I know this Christmas was very different. But even if you didn't have a death in your family recently, perhaps you were self-quarantined because of the pandemic. Or perhaps you were not voluntarily quarantined, but your children or your parents decided that you were going to be quarantined for Christmas. So I want you to think of all those people that you've missed this Christmas, living and deceased, that maybe recently, maybe some time ago, you've become separated from. And I want you to prayerfully offer them signs of God's peace and hear them respond and also with you. Then there are those that maybe you were with, that were, maybe they were able to come to your house, maybe you were able to go be present with them. And I want you to think of them and offer them signs prayerfully of God's peace and say, peace be with you in your prayer, and hear the response and also with you. And then you may be with people now, physically present. You may have someone laid upon your heart in these past two categories or opportunities, and I want you to write those folks a note if they're not there with you. Write it down. Put their name. That if God's laid their name on their heart, send them a message. Call them. Text them. Write them something. Send them a card. Do all of those things. But turn to those near you and offer them signs of God's peace. Peace be with you. God's peace. God's peace be with you. Amen. Let us remain standing as we join in celebrating God's resurrection power.
Call me from the grave by name. You called me out of all my shame. I see the old has passed away. In your royalty, your Holy Spirit lives in me. I see my past has been redeemed. The new has come.
Please be seated. I'm going to ask Reverend Aarons to pray for us.
Gracious God, thank you for all you give us. And Lord, thank you whether our circumstances are good or whether they're not so good. But we know that you have the power and we have freedom in you, even though sometimes we don't feel like it. But we just ask that you bless our tithes and offerings. Help our church, help us to continue to be supported. And Lord, let us bring what is due to you, to you. Guide us now and direct us in everything that we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Tight.
by your life. Tell me to dust your rolls into paradise. All of my dirt, all of my shame, drown in the streams that will make me born again. Like a tide, it is rising up deep inside a current that moves and makes you come alive. Living water that brings the dead to life.
Wonderful lead-in into our scripture reading. Again, we're reading the text assigned for the holy naming of Jesus. It's not one that we normally read, so if you've been following our lectionary reading, I apologize for the confusion. It is one of the options, but it's not designated for this particular Sunday. I've just chosen it for today. So if it is your tradition to stand for the reading of the gospel, I invite you to do so now as we read from the second chapter of the gospel according to Luke, beginning with the 15th verse. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. After 8 days had passed, it was time to circumcise the child, and he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning, friends. I'm glad to see you. I hope that you have had a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. I hope you're still continuing Christmas because we're not out. Remember, we get 12 days to celebrate from December 25th until Wednesday, January 6th, which is the day that those kings are going to finally show up. They're late every year, and they're going to come on Epiphany. So next Sunday, the Magi, the kings, will be with us in the crash as we're going to celebrate Epiphany, Dia de los Reyes, next Sunday. But today is a day that the scripture focuses on naming, on names. And it tells us how important a name is. In the United States, your name is so important that you can't leave the hospital until your mommy and daddy have put your name on what will be your birth certificate. And then a very official piece of paper comes saying, "This is your name," a birth certificate. That's how important it is. They won't even let you leave until you get there. And as you can imagine, if your name is Miss Cursita, well, names are really important, and people knowing our name is important. It's so important that God knew your name even before your mommy and daddy did. Now, I will tell you, Mary had an unfair advantage because an angel and God gave her Jesus' name. But your parents gave you your name. And in those times, the way you were given your name is that your name was like Cressida, daughter of, in this case, it would have been Stan Foreman. And that was your name. It went your name and then Barabat and then whoever your parents were. And so it was important for us to know that that's how important we are to God, that God knows each one of us by name. Now, names are kind of hard right now because when you meet new people, you can't hug them, you can't shake their hands, and blah, 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 you didn't understand what their name was. So we have to work at it because of the masks. But maybe it's a chance to be even more intentional about calling each other by name, like God calls us by name. God knows our name, and God knows us. That's how important you are. That's how important naming baby Jesus was. Will you pray with me with your hands together and your head bowed and your eyes closed? Dear God, thanks for giving me my name. Help me remember that I am so important. You know my name. Thanks for baby Jesus. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
So Cressida was talking about how difficult it is to remember names for some of us, and I am definitely one of those people. I remembered a story this morning as she was sharing with the congregation children's time. When I first started into ministry, I was appointed to the church in Seguin, and the senior pastor, they didn't know they were getting an associate pastor, and so they were kind of surprised that it had worked out, that one was available, and so the senior pastor got up and said, you know, congratulations, congregation, we've been appointed an associate pastor, and his name is Reverend Jim McClain, and I'd like to invite him to stand up and introduce his wife and family. And so I stood up and said, my name is Reverend Jim McClain. It is a blessing to be among you, and this is my wife. Yeah, okay. So I figured I would just go ahead and share that story before somebody else did, because, yeah, it's one of those true stories. This is a busy time of the year, and so, like I said, we're kind of jumping around in part of our lectionary readings. Some of it's chronological, some of it's not, but the reason we jump around and we have so many options is because a lot of those things are tied to dates, and they don't always fall on a Sunday. Wouldn't it be great if we could always have Christmas Eve on a Sunday and then celebrate all day Sunday and then celebrate Christmas on a Monday and have a long weekend? But it doesn't always fall. This year, Christmas Eve fell on a Thursday and Christmas was on a Friday. But the naming of Jesus is always 8 days after Christmas. And so it's the day in Jewish law when the young males were circumcised. And so they were taken to the temple, they were circumcised, and they were given their name. And so 8 days, yes, if you've done the math, this is not today, this is not 8 days after Christmas. It would have been New Year's Day. So we have the option of using those readings. Now, like Cressida said, Epiphany is the 12th day after Christmas. Again, where we came up with 12 days of Christmas, nobody's really sure, but 12 days, and so depending on what day of the week Christmas falls on, Epiphany may or may not fall on a Sunday. But there's a lot of churches that celebrating Epiphany and those readings are very important to them, and so we're going to celebrate those next Sunday. We don't worry, the Magi are going to come, like Cressida said. They're going to be part of our nativity. But now, it's interesting there, and I just say this so that you can kind of get an idea that the chronology doesn't always work. So when we have Herod's response to the Magi, Herod orders all of the male children in the area, 2 years and younger, to be killed in order to protect his throne. We'll talk more about that next week. But so we're not sure when the Magi showed up. But chances are really good that if in 8 days Mary and Joseph took the baby Jesus, they left Bethlehem, went to the temple, went through the ritual of circumcision and naming, They didn't go back to a stable. They went home, all right? And even in some of the scriptures talk about the fact, but we put the Magi in the Nativity as if they showed up 12 days after Christmas every year. So some of this is chronological, some of this is not chronological. Some of it is the time that we celebrate it is based upon time, and some of it's just simply based upon convenience and what Sunday's coming to be. So we don't often get to use these texts. We don't often get to talk about the shepherd's response. We don't often get to talk about what does it mean to take on a name? What does it mean to claim the name of Christian? What does it mean to be given the name of Jesus? How do we deal with this? And so let's just start looking at what can we learn from this text? What can we learn about people? What can we learn about God and how people and God related? And so I'm just going to walk through this text and then I'm going to work backwards and kind of unpack it a little bit. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So God has come to the shepherds and revealed this to them. So they're involved. They're invited. They are encouraged to participate. So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in a manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. So they don't just keep this revelation, they don't just keep this relationship to themselves. They share it with the folks saying, "Hey, we heard this about God, we heard this about the Messiah, we heard this about the Christ child, and we want to share with you what we heard and how we see it being lived out in your life and in our life." But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. Mary takes the word of the shepherds and thinks about them, ponders them in her heart. Can you imagine what it would be like to ponder in your heart what it means to be named the Mother of God? What does that involve? I mean, it's scary enough just being the mother of the firstborn. I mean, I have heard stories that, you know, where the mother says, "Oh my gosh, I don't know what to do. This child didn't come with instructions on the bottom." You know? And so Mary ponders in her heart, what does it mean to be named, to be called the Mother of God? Which in the Methodist Church also reminds us that if God reveals something to the shepherds come and share that information with us. If God reveals something to someone, those people then come and share that with us, that we are entitled, we are invited, we are encouraged to think about and consider the meaning of those words. That in the United Methodist Church, we don't just accept it being spoon-fed. We are invited to think about it. What does it mean? And Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. So again, when we come together and we ponder and we think about the way God has revealed God's self to us in this Christmas season, in this time of COVID, how have we experienced God? Then we go and we share that with others. We go and proclaim to others all that we have seen and heard. And after 8 days had passed, it was time to circumcise the child, and it was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. One of the things that we learn in this text is Mary and Joseph were faithful Jews. They went to church. 8 days. I mean, we talk about how hard it was for Mary to ride the donkey or to walk. We always put her on her donkey. There's no clue that she was riding that donkey, but there's some insinuations. But it makes for a nice picture. But however she got there, at 9 months pregnant, we all admit that was a rough road. And then 8 days later to have to pack everything up and go back to church. They were faithful folks. They attended worship. They went through the rituals. Now, the ritual of circumcision by this time in the Jewish church was being called into question. It became very, very popular and very, very much in vogue and very expected during the Babylonian exile. It was an outward and visible sign of whose name you had taken, of taking on Yahweh's name and becoming the people of Yahweh. And we mark that with an outward and visible sign of circumcision. And the child was named. Now, I was talking to someone just a moment ago, and I asked them what their middle name was, and they said, I was given my middle name at my baptism. It's not on my birth certificate, but it's still my middle name. It's Michael. I did a funeral for a man not too long ago. Well, it's been a long time now. I'm older now, but anyway, time flies. Anyway, I did a funeral for a man, and the family said he was given a new name at his baptism. Will you incorporate that name into the funeral service? Absolutely. So we as Christians celebrate that same event that Mary and Joseph by baptizing our children. Now, we're not locked into 8 days. And not everybody in the United Methodist Church chooses to baptize their children. I have some folks that say, I want my child to grow up and make a decision for themselves. I'm all for that. Whether you're baptized as an infant or you're not baptized as an infant, I am all for that. We as adults, or when we come into adulthood, need to make that decision for ourselves. Do we claim for ourselves the name of Christian as followers of Christ? And what does that name mean? Now, one of my favorite names for the churches that Christina and I have served over our years is, oh, you're that church down the street. I don't go to church, but if I were going to go to church, I would go to that church. That's my favorite name for the churches I serve. The church I would go to if I ever decided to go to church. And I run into those folks, and maybe they had their children baptized, maybe they didn't, but a lot of times it's when we're talking about infant baptism, they'll say things like, well, I want my child to decide for themselves. I'm all for that. I want my children to make their own personal decision of how they will respond to God's grace in their life, how they will respond to something bigger than themselves, guiding and directing and shaping and molding who they are and who they are to become. I am all for that. But oftentimes those folks will say, oh, well, my child grows up, maybe they'll be a doctor, maybe they'll be a lawyer, maybe they'll be the president of the United States, maybe they'll be a teacher, maybe they'll be a nurse. And yet, I've never met one of those parents yet that said, but I'm not going to send them to school so they can learn about what it means to be a nurse. I'm not going to expose them to what it might be to be president. I don't want them to ever see a president that looks like them, because it might encourage them to be president, or it might encourage them to be a doctor or a lawyer. I'm all for people making an informed decision, but where are they going to get the knowledge? How do our children get the information they need to make an informed decision in how they want to respond to God's grace? Mary and Joseph took Jesus to the temple. Jesus was raised in the faith. Now, Jesus, from the very beginning, understood he was a child of God. But he also had to wrestle with, what does it mean to be a child of Mary and Joseph? What does it mean to live into this world, to have these experiences? How do our children make informed decisions if we don't give them the resources to make those decisions with? If they can't choose a name, if they don't know what the name means. The Feast of the Holy Name of Jesus is here because January 1st is 8 days after Christmas. And that day was the day that Jesus, the son of Joseph and the son of Mary, went to church and underwent the liturgical ceremony and the physical act of circumcision. And in those days, at a boy's circumcision, the father gave the child their name. We see that story in John the Baptist. You may recall that John's father, Zechariah, didn't believe the angel Gabriel when the angel said he was going to have a child in his old age. And Zechariah couldn't couldn't speak for the entire 9 months of the pregnancy. He could only listen to people questioning him, making fun of him, challenging him. The Hebrew name that we write as Jesus is actually a compound name, kind of like Cressida said. You've got your given name. Remember when we used to call given names? And then you've got your surname, where you have your given name, but you also have who you're related to or what your pedigree is or a son of or daughter of. The name that we write as Jesus is a compound word that shows up in the Old Testament as Joshua. It's formed from the shortening of God's name of Yahweh to Yah, and the verb to save. God saves. The verb shua. The term Yah for Yahweh is given to God on Mount Sinai by God. God chose that name when Moses asked God, "Who shall I say sent me?" Yahweh means I am who I am. Or maybe better can be translated, I am, and watch what I am going to do. It's more than just a term of being. It's a name of action. What does your name call you to do? When we adopt that name of Christian, is it a name of action? Now, sometimes you hear people misuse the name of God, don't you? Maybe even as something as simple as OMG on social media. And you see the text, and maybe you want to respond with, don't do that, or you shouldn't use God's name that way. Or maybe you've been in a situation where somebody hits their thumb with a hammer and says, Jesus. You know, or maybe even more than that, Jesus Christ. What if you use that as an opportunity of prayer? And said, Jesus, God saves. Or as one of my staff said, and God loves you very, very much. Jesus loves you very, very much. Or maybe just simply when they say, OMG, say, have mercy. How do we live into that name when other people abuse that name? How do we claim that name? It's important. It's important knowing the name that you claim. It's important knowing what that name means and how you live into that name. It's important to know the values, the responsibilities, the character that that name reflects. On occasions when my daughter was dating quite a bit and living at home, when she got picked up to go out on a date, and I always like the guy to come in and meet the guy, and you know, so maybe you do, maybe you don't. But there are still times when she'd say, hi, I'm gone, I'm bye. And not always, but evidently enough, I would say, remember who you are. Remember who you are. In fact, she asked me one time to write that out. I don't know how you feel about tattoos, but this tattoo I kind of like. She has the picture of Simba with the mark of Simba's being identified as a child of the king tattooed right about here. Now, she may freak out that I'm telling all of you this. And around it, it says, remember who you are. And I'll have to be honest. When she was young and dating, I thought that was a really nice place to have that little reminder right there on her hip. Remember who you are. It's important when we take on the name of Jesus, when we claim to be children of the Son of God, to remember who we are. The shepherds were invited. They were included. To claim the name of God, to recognize the Messiah, to know the child named God saves. Yeshua, Joshua, Jesus. So what does it mean when we pray in the name of Jesus? Is it some magic phrase that makes it come true? Or is it a reminder of the name that we follow, of who's claimed us, and our responsibility to live into those prayers? The shepherds were invited. They were told the story, and they responded with glory and praise and adoration. How do we respond to people that come into our lives that want to be part of our church? Or maybe that have voted differently and are posting on Facebook and we're really tired of what they have to say in social media. How do we respond? This is a story that came from the tale of the tardy ox cart by Charles Swindoll. You may have heard it before. Frances Green was an 83-year-old woman in California who lived by herself and whose only means of support was her Social Security check. She didn't have much money, but for 8 years she had been sending $1 a year to the Republican National Committee. And well, one day, Frances got a fundraising letter in the mail from the RNC, and it was on beautiful cream paper with black and gold lettering, and it invited the recipient to come to the White House to meet President Reagan. But she didn't read all the way to the bottom, and what she hadn't noticed was that the invitation implied this was only for those who would give a generous donation. She just thought she had been invited because they appreciated her dollar a year of support. So Frances got all excited and she scraped together every cent that she had to take this 4-day train ride from California to Washington, D.C. And when she arrived at the White House gate, the guard saw a beautiful little elderly woman with white hair and white powdered face, all over her face, wearing white stockings, an old white hat with white netting, and an all-white dress that had yellowed just a little bit with age. And she gave the guard her name, and the guard looked over the list and frowned. Her name wasn't there. She couldn't go in. As you can imagine, she was heartbroken. Nearby, waiting to go in, who had also received an invitation, was somebody from the Ford Motor Company, and he overheard the interaction, and he told her that obviously there had been some mistake and that she should come back tomorrow morning at 9. And then he got word to President Reagan, and President Reagan agreed to see her. At 9 o'clock, she arrived, full of anticipation and excitement. And in spite of the fact that this was the President of the United States, and was very busy with high-level meetings, when she came into his office, he got up from his desk and greeted her, said, "Frances, those darn computers, they fouled up again. If I'd have known you were coming, I would have come out there and got you myself." And then he sat down with her, and they talked for an hour about her life, her family, and about the city she lived in. And Frances felt important, because the President of the United States said she was important. What does it mean when you take on the title of president? What does it mean when you take on the title of pastor? What does it mean when you take on the title of Christian? So when people get through talking to you, on January 7th, after whatever happens on January 6th happens, how are you going to respond? It's not just Epiphany Sunday. There's some national events that are going to take place on January 6th. After you visit with your children, how do they feel? Do they walk away feeling valued? When you visit with your coworkers, do they walk away feeling respected? When you talk to your employees, when they're through with a conversation, do they feel capable and encouraged? How about your fellow students if you're in school? After visiting with you, do they feel like they're accepted as part of the group? What about your friends that believe the same way you do, that enjoy being around you, when they leave the conversation and you've talked about other people, do they feel cherished and safe? And how about those who voted differently? How will they feel on January 7th? Will they feel loved? The shepherds were invited to take on the name of Christian. And Mary and Joseph recognized their invitation and accepted them and listened to their story and invited them to take on the name of believers of Christ, to take on the name of followers of Joshua, the Messiah. And so as we gather here together, this table is open. If you've not gathered up your communion elements, do so now. We'll have time while we're going through the great Thanksgiving. Remember that God is present wherever you are, and that God has been involved in blessing these elements from a distance virtually for thousands of years. And so we believe God can join us together in the breaking of the bread and the sharing of the cup this morning.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. You revealed to your servant Moses how your priests are to bless your people. And so with all the people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. At his name every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit.
On the night in which he gave himself up for us, the Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, and again he gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at the heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forevermore. Amen. And now with the confidence that we are indeed the children of God, we are bold when we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. If you're using some of the elements that we have chosen to use during COVID, if you'll peel back that top layer and take the wafer, this is the body of Christ broken for you. Take, eat, and be comforted. And if you'll peel back the second layer to reveal the juice in the cup, This is the blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Drink ye all of this. And now, if you would join with me in our prayer after receiving. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We respond to God's love and God's grace into our life by reminding ourselves of who we are and who we are, but more importantly, of who God is. If you would like to make this your church home, let us know. We would love to move you from being simply an observer to being a participant. That may mean different things to many people, but if you want to say, I want to claim the name of Christ for myself, and I want to do it through the congregation of Windcrest United Methodist Church, you can put it in the comment section. You can send us an email. If you happen to be here, come forward as we sing our closing song, talking about God's love, God's reckless love. Let us sing.
Coming after me.
Please be seated if you're here with us. I would like to introduce to you our two newest members who joined virtually since we last got together Sunday.
Members of the congregation, I'd like to introduce to you our newest members. They've been very active in our church for some time, and we're waiting for COVID to actually make this format, so they may be our first formal in the midst of COVID members that have come through online. So I would like to introduce Bruce and Pat Thompson. They come to us from other denominations. And so as members of Christ Universal Church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church and do all in your powers to strengthen its ministries?
I will.
As members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness?
I will.
Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm them in hope, and perfect them in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the whole body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Welcome.
I do hope that you'll have an opportunity to welcome Bruce and Pat. Send them an email or a card. Wave at them if you happen to see them at the grocery store. And now please stand and receive this blessing. May the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Go forth as children of God. Go forth in peace. Amen.
Oh, the overwhelming.